Okay, I think I will going to start. So if someone can would be able to close the door, because it's pretty noisy outside. Can someone close the door? Okay. Thanks. Okay, so my name is Marek Grabowski, and I'm a software engineer from Google working on Kubernetes scalability. My goal in this presentation, like I have two goals in this presentation. First, the simple one is that I want to show you what we did in the past year to go from supporting 100 nodes to supporting 2,000 nodes, well, in 1.4 release. But the more important thing is that I want you to all understand what exactly do we mean when we say that Kubernetes supports X node clusters. The work I will be talking about was mostly done by us in Warsaw from Google Office. People from Red Hat, most notably Clayton, Timothy Sinclair, and the CoreOS guys, so Hong Chao and Xian, whatever, sorry if I pronounce it wrong, but I just don't know how to do it. And it was like overseen by the SIG scalability, which was the first SIG as Dan or someone mentioned during the keynote. It meets on Thursdays, like 6 p.m. Central European time. It's probably like 9 a.m. or something on West Coast. So if someone is interested in joining this effort and sharing his thoughts with us, like please come to the SIG meetings and do. We are running like for, I don't know how long, but like the longest running SIG for now, and we're still meeting like every single week. Okay, so everything started for us at least, and the scalability in Kubernetes in winter last year, when we joined the Kubernetes project. Back then, Kubernetes, I don't know if someone will believe me, but we were able to compile the whole Kubernetes in like few seconds, I think 2 or 3 seconds, and it was clean compiled from the scratch to the fully built Kubernetes cluster system. Right now, it takes minutes. And we were just completely in the dark. Like we didn't have any idea like how many nodes we can support. Hell, we didn't knew what does this support mean. Like we absolutely knew nothing. We had a system. So when you get a system and you want to make sure it scales, how do you start? Well, you start by writing some tests. Something strange going on with the mic. So the simplest test you can think of is you just create a cluster and start as many pods as you can and see if it will work and how quickly you can start them and so on and so forth. So that was the first test we wrote. We just create a cluster, start however many pods you can, and then delete all of them. This is called the density test. The second, like this is like obviously like pretty simple scenario, and it's not really representative for most of the workloads. So we wrote also the second test, which is a bit more complex. It just starts a number of pods in like a number of replication controllers, and then over some time it scales some of the replication controllers up, some of them down, and just generates a load on the API server by creating and deleting pods. This is the load test. And those tests that we wrote like a year ago are still the base of how we test the Kubernetes at scale in the open source. Like other companies, I know that the Red Hat in the OpenShift have different, like the more tests to run, but like for open source Kubernetes, this is the, well, sadly or the only things that we have right now. And when we got this test written, we ran them, and the results, well, were bad. But we actually didn't know what the bad mean, right? Like what the bad means. We get some results, and they're just like feeling not good. So like you get the results that I feel bad, and you need to quantify what does the bad mean. So the next thing we did was to define the SLOs, as we call them, for the system. And we have two of them. First of all, one is the simplest you can think of. The API call response time should be under 1 second, right? So you issue the request to the API server, and you get the response in under 1 second. Pretty simple one. The second one is end-to-end pod startup latency, because that's actually the thing that people are interested in when running Kubernetes. They want to start something. So how quickly can Kubernetes start a thing? So this is the second SLO. So the pod startup latency should be under 5 seconds. Well, obviously, assuming that the image is already on the machine when it starts, because like downloading gigabyte of an image will take more than 5 seconds, and we just can't do anything about it. And that. No, it's just like the simplest. The definition is kind of complex, but basically it's just like to create a simple pod without any provisioning, because it's like really cloud provider specific. Like how quickly we can mount a volume, it depends on where you run. And this is like, as I said, like the open source version, so we actually don't want to depend on environment that you're running Kubernetes. We only want to measure the stuff that will be consistent across development. And that's when our work began. We had tests, load test and density test, and two SLOs that we want to meet. And this is something when you actually can start doing some work, real work. So you have some metrics you want to optimize, you know how you measure them, and now go for it and, well, make it better. We released the Kubernetes 1.0 like over a year ago, and it was supporting 100 nodes. It's not a very big number, as we all know. But it wasn't actually it wasn't working even on 100 nodes when we started. Like, it was really wasn't able to handle even this small number of nodes. And to understand why was this the case, I need to dive in a bit into the details on how actually the system works on a very high level. Let's call normal requests. It looks like it's pretty straightforward. So the user sends the request to the API server, which then forwards it in a sense to the etcd, so the database key value store in which we keep the cell state. Then it gets a response from the etcd and forwards it to the user. Well, by user here I mean either a person using kubectl or any component that actually contacts with the API server. This is how the API kind of on a very high level looks like API requests. Of course, we have the other ones, like we have the watch request, which looks in a slightly different way. We have proxy, which, well, creates a proxy, which obviously does not have like a single response. But for like the most interesting ones that actually are used in other components, this is like pretty good as the description. But that's not the only thing that's going on. We also do a lot of conversions between types. So user, like especially in 1.0, user were able to, well, was sending the request to the API server using, well, JSON or YAML. I use JSON because I don't want to write JSON/YAML all around the place, but like it's some pretty explicit format. The API server is written in Go, so it operates on Go structs. So, well, when it gets the JSON and it needs the Go struct, so it does some conversion, so some unmarshalling on the JSON. But etcd stores JSON inside, like in 1.0 version. source JSON. So to actually put something to the etcd, it needs to, well, marsh a JSON again from this ghost track it worked on. It's actually worse than that. Because as we all know, like, we version our APIs. So it actually, the marshalling of JSON actually goes to the versioned, versioned structure, like version type. So first, when the user sends a request in versioned JSON, it gets translated to the versioned Go. Then API server actually works in like internal structure, which is unversioned. So we do a conversion to the unversioned Go struct. Then, like, when writing to etcd, it goes the other way, and then of course when we make response on the way back, we actually do need to do it again. So there's a lot of conversions going on behind the scenes. A slight advertisement, like, Daniel will be talking like in details about this API machinery at 3:40 p.m. Today. So if someone's interested in how exactly does it work, he will explain it in a lot of detail. And this was the first problem that prevented us from running on 100 node clusters when we started. Like, marshalling of JSON is sadly expensive. We all know that it's not the lightest thing you can do. But there's a lot of open source things, like the libraries that can do it. So we chose Ugori because it was the best we can choose at that point. And we're currently stuck with it right now. But very expensive conversion, surprisingly, is the one from versioned Go structure to the versioned Go type to the unversioned one. They're kind of similar, actually. Like, usually it's like actually even identical. Sometimes the unversioned type has some fields that were added after the version API was cut. So it's actually, it should be really simple, right? The problem is that when you want to do it in a generic way, you use reflection in Go. And reflections are slow, like really slow. So, like, we encountered this problem and had to find a solution because it was like just trashing our CPU. So what did we do? We wrote a code generator that writes a functions that do these conversions for us without using reflection. Like, reflection was needed only to make like a generic code that will always run and no one will need to update it every single time it adds or changes API because that's unmaintainable. But actually, it's pretty simple in some way to write a Go code that will do exactly the same without using the reflection. And we just wrote a code generator that was actually started with this from this effort. Right now, it generates like a lot of other stuff around the system that can write optimized Go code to do those conversions. And this was enough to get us to 100 nodes. This was the thing that we did for the first release. But it's kind of like done, right? Like, you have like optimal conversions pipeline, you have like the best JSON marshaller you were able to find, and like optimized Go, generated Go to do the conversion. So that's done. When you want Go higher, you need to find another bottleneck, right? Like the next one. Because like you can't do much more with this conversion thing. The next thing that was appearing a lot in the profiles we did on the API server was handling watches. Watch is the RPC, like the streaming request. So basically, user creates a watch on the server and asks the server to give him an update if there will be some changes on this kind of object. So like, I want to watch nodes. And every time any node object changes, API server will send the request, data to the user that this node object was changed in that way. Basically, just like the user keeps open connection and the API server sends the data every time it has something to send. In the 1.0 Kubernetes version, it was like the implementation was extremely simple. A etcd client does support watches, so when the user created watch, we created the etcd watch and just like piped it together. Well, it's simple implementation, but pretty simple also to see when it goes wrong. Like we have like a number of clients that watch exactly the same things, like nodes, like kubelets watches nodes, for example. So you just create like lots of these unnecessary watches on the etcd side of the picture. What's actually even worse is that because you create these watches on etcd, you do this like the right-hand side conversion. So the conversions that you actually need to do to write or read from the etcd. Because like the etcd works on JSON and you won't go, so like if you just pipe this watch, you still get the JSON and need to transform it to Go. Solution is obviously like pretty obvious, like for pretty much all of us who work on the distributed system, you just add a cache in the API server, which does create single watch for the given object type. So like if a number of users want to watch nodes, we do not create like the same number of watches in etcd, but create only a single one and then just dispatch the results to all the clients that are interested in it, right? We call it cacher because actually it stores the way it's implemented, it actually caches all data from the etcd. So it's a kind of like the etcd replica, which is, first of all, stores the Go structures, and secondly, it's in the process of API server, so like there's no inter-process communication needed. And surprisingly, this was enough to reach 250 nodes. But I want to remind all of you that support means for the density and load tests, we meet those two SLOs, right? Like the API call latency is 1 second, and end-to-end pod startup latency is 5 seconds. That's everything we measure right now. 1.2 happens sometime later, and when we wanted to hit 1,000 nodes. And when you start getting to this kind of scale, you start to experience like completely different problems that you were before. Like the first, you just notice that testing gets really annoying, right? Like when you test, like want to test 1,000 node cluster, you need to, well, pay for it, that's one thing, right? And like the rough estimate is like what, 1 hour, 1 core hour costs like 5 cents, so 1,000 core hours is $50. And tests obviously run long, so it's like a good lunch, really good lunch in like really good New York restaurant. It's not prohibitively expensive, but it starts like being noticeable. Also, things break way more often. Like if, for example, there's a bug in kubelet that happens, whatever, 1 in 100 times, like in 1% of cases, like if you run like tests on 3 nodes, well, you probably won't hit it. If you're like on a 1,000 nodes, you will most likely hit it, right? Like, so it's something will break. And we know that the Docker is not very stable. It does have bugs. Like there's like a number of like things that caused like the kubelet to just completely stop because like Docker daemon was in some bad state and it just broke the thing. It happened like in 1% of the cases, which didn't have any like big impact on normal tests, but on a scale test, we just weren't able to run anything because like cluster's not working. And the biggest problem is that it takes a lot of time. Even like provisioning like 1,000 machines just takes time, right? And also you can't really but it's hard to convince anyone to allow you to run this like in parallel. If you want like to quickly iterate, then you won't need to like create 1,000 node clusters. Then you start running tests. You probably won't be able to run like the second test like after some small improvement that you did along the way. like in the same time, like because like running like 1,000 code, sorry, 1,000 machines is probably okay. Like running 5,000, like five tests in parallel, probably not okay. So that's like the problem we noticed, and we created a solution, which is called KubeMark. We just simulate clusters. Actually, when we are optimizing the master component, so the things that run on the like the API server, controller, manager, scheduler, the things that run the cluster, we actually do not care a lot about nodes themselves, right? Like we do not try to benchmark how kubelet works, which means what you can do, pretty simple thing, like you can create like the real master, the normal master we all know and love, and then create a number of like what we call hollow nodes, like the nodes that actually do not use Docker daemon. They have some mock for it, like the fake Docker daemon, fair runtime something, and also fake kubeproxy because we don't want to override IP tables on the same machine like in like number of times in the same moment. And when we created it, it just solved like most of those problems. You can create them like this is incredibly quickly because like you just create one machine, and you have like the Kubernetes cluster, which actually runs this Hollows nodes. Like we have like external cluster that runs like the simulated nodes, and you can just like create and they run as pods, so you can just like start and delete them like as quickly as you want. And this became like the main tool we use when testing the changes we want to make. We can, we are running 15 to 17 hollow nodes per single core, which means that for 1,000 nodes we need whatever 70 cores or something. So like 32 core machines, which is like pretty quick to we can spin up pretty quickly. Okay, so but that's the testing part. So like how we were able to make the work faster. Now back to the improvements we had to make to reach this 1,000 node goal. This is the picture that I already described. So like we have this API request, and we can split the API request on two kinds, like write requests that just need to go to the etcd and we can't do anything about it, and read requests that we can kind of do the same thing we did with the watch thing. So we have this cache that stores the data from the etcd, and we can just serve the read requests from it. There's only one problem. Like before we started this work, like the kind of like the contract, we agreed on a similar contract that when you write something, so you just create a new resource, whatever, pod, node, something, and directly after you read it from etcd, you will just see it, right? Like you just get the thing that you just created. And this is like the contract like a lot of people have. And when you have this cache, it is slightly late, right? Like because like it needs to observe the watch from the etcd and then apply the changes to its state. So it's slightly off. So we actually can't really serve the standard get request from it because like the get is the thing that you actually need to have like the fresh ones. But for lists, like when we just list all the nodes, and for controllers we run, like this kind of like delay is perfectly okay. Like as long as it's eventually consistent, we're fine. Like if we observe that the pod was created like whatever 1 second later, it's fine. Like nothing will break, we'll just start it 1 second later, it will be perfectly fine. Or when we notice that node is unhealthy, like 1 second later, like maybe someone cares if we just start evicting nodes like after 5 seconds exactly on 5 minutes exactly on 5 minutes and 1 second. But like this was really like unmaintainable like for at this scale because of the thing that I already mentioned previously, like. All of those lists would need to, that will go from the etcd would need to be first unmarshal JSON, then like this all conversion need to happen, then we need to marshal it again and send it to the user. And this was just consuming like enormous amounts of CPU in API server. So what we did, we modified the list a bit so that when you do a list on the API server, you can specify if you want, if you're absolutely certain you want the freshest data, then we just forward it to etcd. But if you're fine if in having like whatever a second delay, then you can just write it from the cache and it will be way, way faster. So if you will be writing any controllers for Kubernetes, you should keep it in mind that if you don't really need like the freshest data that are currently at CD, you should use the cache.
Could you make a quick comment on what happens if you're running multiple API servers?
Well, that depends on your HI setup.
So is the API server the only bottleneck for scaling?
No, but it's the most important. I will have a slide like, why is that. Now, quickly, because like this will be the pretty simple thing. So in 1.3 release, we said that we support 2,000 nodes. And like everything that we were able to serve from cache was already served from cache. So like the first, we just like finished the things we can do with the conversions. In 1.2, we finished the things we can do with the caches. So we need to find like another thing to do. This another thing to do is the format in which clients communicate with the API server. As I said, JSON is not very efficient. But luckily, there is an open source alternative for JSON, and those are protocol buffers that will probably be the part of CNCF at some point. Protocol buffers are, like, I think, like order of magnitude smaller than JSONs, and serializing and deserializing uses way less CPU. So it's just better format, but like during the transfer, it's a binary format, so you actually can't read it without like doing the serialization. So in 1.3. we taught the API server to accept the protocol buffers as input for all the creates, gets, updates, whatnot, and switched all of our internal clients, like controllers, scheduler, kubelets, kubeprocs, I believe, to actually use protocol buffers instead of JSON as the format in which they get, read, and process data. And this was huge. This actually allowed us to go from 1,000 to 2,000 nodes, like 2 times increase in like already quite big scale. And this should actually like tell you like how very bad JSON is in this context. So we're currently using it internally. Like internally, I mean inside Kubernetes cluster. But like if user wants, you can talk to the API server using protocol buffers as well. It will be faster. Though I think that kubectl does not support protocol buffers file, the definitions like files as an input yet. So like if you want to use them, you just need to just send direct like use rest directly. And that was everything that had to be done actually to support like to move from 1,000 nodes to 2,000 nodes. In 1.4, we were still supporting 2,000 nodes, so we actually weren't doing anything. From the big things, but the reason is actually more complex. It's that the 1.5 is coming, and we wanted to support 5,000 nodes, and this required like a very big change, probably the biggest change in Kubernetes for now. We need to migrate from etcd v2 to etcd v3. This is like the database, but like the changes like between those two versions are huge. It's a different binary protocol, and what most important data formats. Etcd2 and etcd3 store data in a different way. And because like we do care about like production quality Kubernetes, when we do this migration, we first of all need a tools that allow you to convert the data from etcd2 to etcd3, but we also need a tooling that will allow you to convert back if you need to do a rollback. right? That's really important. And plus, we also need to use this new protocol before, you know, like teach the Kubernetes to use this new version of protocol. But that was like quite small in comparison to this like migration tooling. This takes a lot of time. It is quite unlikely, but it's possible that we won't be able to do it for 1.5 even. Like it's on track, but like it is no zero, probably like 1% chance that we won't be able to do it, which will be bad. Because we just can't scale higher than 2,000 nodes with a CDV2. And we really need to move to the new SCD to just like be able to go higher. And with that, we do the protocol buffers on the other side of the picture. So like in SCD2, we were storing JSON. In SCD3, we will be storing protocol buffers, which also saves some CPU cycles on the right-hand side of the picture. So like no more like JSON marshalling. And marshalling on the SCD side, we will use protocol buffers all throughout the stack. And now answering the very important question, why I talk about the API server mostly? Well, the reason is that it is by far the most important thing when it comes to performance of the Kubernetes cluster, how the Kubernetes cluster feels when you use it. And to show you why, I will create a deployment. So I will just like quickly, well, as quickly as I can, show you what happens when you create a deployment and wait until the pod from this deployment will be running. So it starts when user sends a create deployment request to the API server, which is then forwarded to etcd. API server gets a response, and like if someone's watching, it just like distributes the responses throughout the staff that are watching for them. So like the user sees that the deployment was created, and deployment controller sees that the deployment was created. Deployment controller sees new deployment, so what it does, it creates a replica set for it. So it sends a replica set, create replica set request, it gets forwarded to etcd, it gets back to the API server, and it gets distributed for everyone who actually is listening for it. Now the important piece is the replica set controller, which now observes that the replica set is created. So what does the replica set controller sees when the replica set is created? It creates a pod for it. So the pod is created, it's forwarded to etcd, and the story continues, right? Like after this piece of this is done, scheduler observes a new pod. So scheduler observes a new pod, which does not have the node name set, which means it's unscheduled. So it processes it and binds the pod to a node. So it sets the node name in pod spec, so it updates pod spec, API server updates the pod spec in etcd, it gets the response. And now kubelet sees that some pod has, there is a new pod that has the node name set to its node. So it actually observes the pod creation. It starts the pod and updates the pod status that the pod is running, which gets forwarded to etcd, gets a response. And here is when the user sees that the pod is actually running. Right, like there was, I don't know, 20 slides or something, and in every single one of them, API server was doing something. Right, and this means like that whatever you do, API server will do a lot of work to make it happen. This is exactly why I was mostly talking about API server, because like this is a central component of the system, and if it is slow, everything goes haywire. API server is just a thin layer, actually. It's just like forward stuff to etcd and reset. Like that's, well, we can split it between objects. Like we do it with like events or have the separate etcd, for example. But like there's nothing else to split, right? Like there's an admission control which has to be done, needs to be done, and there's like the communication database with caching.
So going back to his question, if you were running multiple API servers, which is multi-master situation, would the would you multiply the number of nodes that it can, the cluster can support?
No.
Why?
Well, that depends. Well, first of all, it depends. And secondly, the etcd also is important part. And when you run multi-master, you still you have some consensus algorithm. In etcd, it's Raft, not Paxos, but it's still like this is a single thing that you actually, well, that's kind of like the abstraction of a single database. And we actually hit the like that the reason why we can't go higher is that the etcd tool just can't handle more load. Yes? It really depends on how you set up HA. Like we currently do not have official HA set up, so I can't give you a good answer.
Question: how about the minnow node? I mean, we have so many node. How about the server right now? Like, do the upping?
Sorry, I don't understand.
Suppose if one of the slave node die, it might take a while to detect it with so many.
Well, it depends on the settings. But like we can talk about it later. Actually, I also like take care of the node controller, which actually handles like the node failures. But like I'll just like a few more slides. So actually, right now I can define the 2SO load more precisely. As I said, it is a bit more complex than that I told. So we measure the pod end-to-end entire pod startup latency from the time when the pod object is created in the etcd. Which is that just after the replica set controller created a pod, it was written to the etcd server, to the time when user space watch observed that the pod is running, which is the last slide. So this is the thing that should be under 5 seconds in the tests we run, right? Yeah, so that's it. And also there's another part in this second SLO that I wasn't talking about already, and it's scheduler. Well, that scheduler is pretty simple, one can think, but like even simple scheduling, simple scheduling is actually quite complex. Our scheduler works in the following way. When one wants to create a pod, we compute so-called predicate functions, which basically take all the nodes in the cluster and says on which of them this pod can run at all. Like for on other day maybe like not enough CPU left or for some reason it's not good for this pod. When we have this list of things that where we can run at all, we compute so-called priority functions, which just grade those nodes. How well this pod will fit on a given node, like for this particular priority function. Then we take all the results, sum the priority functions, and then pick the best node. Until 1.4, scheduler was single-threaded. It was basically just looping through all of those things, like for every single predicate, it was looping through all the nodes and all the pods that's already scheduled in a cluster to produce the results. And well, on the flip side, it was using like one CPU on the master machine, so it wasn't really a starving KPI server. What we started to do in the 1.4 and kind of finished 1.5 is like we like introduced like framework for the priority functions, which were like the profiles shown heavier ones. So like how the priorities were much more straining on the CPU than predicate functions, and we now basically, well, everyone who knows what MapReduce is probably can figure it out. Like we create like a separate go routine for every single node and every single for every single node and every single priority function, and then it just computes the priority for this particular node. After we get all this data, we just sum it over the, like for every single node, we sum all of them and just do the standard comparison. So like the reduce function. This together with like some simple optimizations that basically made us like use pointers instead of copying stuff around in the scheduler code, improved the scheduler throughput like 4 to 5 times. So this is big. On the bad side, like right now, scheduler, when it's trained, uses more CPU than the API server. And it's quite a lot. To wrap up, we wanted to support 5,000 nodes for V1.5. We probably won't be able to do this. Because like the etcd thing turned out to be way more time consuming than we assumed. We will support more than 2,000. We don't know how much more. We'll see in a few weeks, right? How well we do. And remember, when we say that we support 5,000 nodes, well, we'll say that we'll support like whatever X nodes. It will mean that the 99% of API call response times will be under 1 second, and end-to-end port startup latency should be under 5 seconds in the density and load test that we are running. So they are pretty simple. The good news is that we know that they are by far not enough. We know, like we just had to have like a starting point to just start working on something. And once we reach certain level, like I think that 5,000 is the number that we wanted to reach, we can actually start to extend this, like expand the SLOs, add new ones, like measure more things than just the API call response time or with this simple, when the simple pods are running in the simple tests. We can start working on more complex tests that I think Jeremy will be talking about like tomorrow from Red Hat. So we are working on making it better and like more meaningful for users. So that's all I had today. So thank you all for the attention.